software that help enterprises to run their business. And openSAP is the provider for massive open, SAP's provider for massive open online courses. So we provide online courses for free in the internet in a very specific format, the MOOC format. Just a question, who of you knows what MOOC is?
We've been to the video studio.
I guess we get it.
Who already participated in MOOC? At least a few. And an openSAP MOOC? Wow, still a few who taught in openSAP MOOC. We also have a few. Okay, wonderful. So just a few words about a MOOC is, or what we understand under MOOC. It means massive open online course, massive because there are thousands of people in one course, open because it's unrestricted and free. So everybody who wants to join can join. The only thing you need is an email address, a password, a browser's internet access, and then you can participate in the course. An online course just means, well, it's not a classroom. We have a few facts about our team. So this is us. We are around 30 people based in Canada, Germany, India, Ireland, and the US. OpenSAP was founded in 2030, and we just celebrate our 5th birthday. The course is already quite big. We have around 3.7 million enrollments. We have more than 870,000 learners. And the satisfaction with the platform is quite high. So we are very proud that 98% of the learners say that they like the learning experience. The main purpose of having OpenSAP is that we as a company have the challenge that we come up with lots of innovation. Innovations, but the innovation cycles are getting shorter and shorter, and it's not enough anymore that someone goes in a class once a year and learns about everything what's new. We need another and more flexible way to inform the world and to teach the world what we have and how they can use it. And this flexible way is, well, this is just us, this is OpenSAP. As said, most of our courses are around our own innovations and the SAP products, but we also have a few courses that stay under the umbrella of corporate social responsibility, and they are around IT education. And here you see also quite a few SNAP courses, courses about the code week. And now I want to talk about a course that is not related to SNAP at all, which is this one here in the corner. Kann ich mich nie erfolgreich in der Schule einsetzen? It's a German course, but we'll try to translate for those who are not able to speak German. So the title is, as said, kann die Open Media erfolgreich in der Schule einsetzen, translated into English. This means using the Open Media successfully in schools. And one question might be, what the hell is the Open Media? This is the small microcontroller that the girls hold before their eyes. I also have one here in case you want to have a look of it. The idea behind is that to teach even smaller children the basics of, well, how the digital work works. And this is also the reason why this microcontroller has such a funny shape, so it looks like a star, so it's quite appealing even for smaller children, also for girls that are usually not so tech-y. And the purpose or the reason or the goal is that the children do not just use a computer or laptop, their mobile phone or whatever, but they also know what's behind the screen, how's it working behind the screen. The problem that we have, at least here in Germany, is that teachers who should teach the children, they don't have so much IT background. And as this community is for smaller children, teachers in elementary school should be able to tell the people, well, how to use it, but they don't have the knowledge. And what we want to do in our course, what we did, is that we teach teachers how this device works and how they can program it and how to use it in school or in schools. So now I show you how the course or how our platform works, and I will use this course as an example. So when you want to go to our platform, first you need to know the URL. It's quite easy. It's open.sap.com. And if you type that in, then you are on our main check out what courses we have, and want to just click on courses here at the top. And then the course list opens, and the first thing you see is that we have different course categories. So we have your current courses, and if you scroll down a little bit, then you have upcoming courses, and if you still scroll down, then we have self-paced courses. So these three categories, and the question is, well, what's the difference? Current courses, or our courses, always have a start and end date, and during this time the course team supports the course. So the course team is in the discussion forum. So if you go through the course, you have a question, you're not alone, you just type in the discussion forum, hey, I don't understand that. And then within 24 hours, at least this is our goal, you have an answer to your question, at least an initial answer. Sometimes it's more difficult, and we need a little bit longer, but at least we have an initial answer. The upcoming courses are courses, well, that start in the future. And the self-paced courses are courses that are still over, so you reach the end date, then the course form closes, but all the content is still available. So let's now check for our course. So we have to scroll down here a little bit. The course closed 2 weeks ago. So here we are. If I click here, then I come to the course page. Here I get all the information, what is this course about, for whom is it, etc. If I'm interested and I say yes, interesting for me, then I just enroll in the course. Now the system asks me for my credentials. If I don't have an account yet, then I have to set up one. So I hope I type it right. Already wrong.
So safe that even you can be
super safe. So now it works. Okay. So now the system recognizes me. Here, this is my Helga Mustermann user, so German people know it's just a fake name. Now I can see my dashboard, so what courses that I already participated in. I can change my profile, I can see and download all my certificates, change my settings as well. And here, let's come back to the course. Here we have the course. So I'm now in the learning section. And what you see here is Woche 1, 2, 3, 4. For those who don't know German, that means week 1, 2, 3, 4. So what we do is we divide the content into chunks. The reason for this is most of our learners are professionals, so they cannot spend hours of learning in a row, right? They cannot sit for 2 days or so just learning, but they can spend around 2 or 4 hours each week and can invest that in learning. And this is just how we do it. Each week comprises a learning effort of approximately 2 to 4 hours. And the way it works is that when the course starts, week one opens, and then the content of week one is available. And at the end of the week, there's a weekly assignment with a deadline. You have one attempt to do it. You have 1 or 2 hours to go to the test, and the test checks, well, did you really understand the content of this week? And when you do the test, you get some points, and then week two opens. Again, you have a deadline, and by moving through the course, you get some points, and if you have enough points, then you get a record of achievement. So it's quite simple. The reason why we do it is we want to avoid that people procrastinate. So I think everybody of you already tried to do an online course, and then you think, oh, I can do it next week or the week after. And so with these deadlines, we try that people really keep going. The core of our courses are videos. So in the videos, the teacher explains in short videos. This one is about, I think, 7 or 8 minutes long. The teacher or expert explains the content, and then after, or demonstrates something, and after each video we have an interaction or an action. Usually this is a self-test, so just multiple choice test, the check, well, they really understand what we told you in the video, or even better, here an exercise where they can really check, can I really apply what I have learned. When I have a question, I can ask directly below the video, there's a button, hey, I have a question, then the discussion forum opens, you can ask a question, and as I said, within 24 hours you get an answer, or you can go directly in the discussion forum and you can ask your question, or you can discuss with others. Usually you go in and then you go out, so in the progress you see how far you have come, and in green, for those who can see colors, in green, this is the items I already visited, and in orange, yeah, we have one person here, can see colors. In orange, this is still open. What we also have is an app, so you can also use the app, download the videos, and watch the videos offline while you're traveling, for example. We also have the option of collab spaces. These are, my mouse is not working. Of collab spaces. These are kind of breakout rooms. Also, there's a long discussion forum, the possibility to upload files, etc. In this course, we had a collab space called Bastel Ecke. I cannot translate that. It's a making.
Tinkering corner.
A tinkering corner. There, some techies met and exchanged some technical stuff about the device itself. Okay, in the first 2 weeks, we really taught them about what is this kind of really, what is on it, how to program it, even how to open an editor, how to, it's we use make code and open Roberta as a programming language, how to put together all the blocks, etc. So really step by step, so that they felt confident and had the feeling, oh well, now I got it. And in the last 2 weeks, we then explained how can they bring that into the school, what are some arguments that they can convince other teachers, what are some organizational or technical tips and tricks. And then we were really curious if it worked. So we had a survey at the end of the course and asked them a few questions. I have picked two of them here. So I said it's voluntary, so 600 something answered the question. The first question was, do you have now the feeling that you can work with such a colleague or community, that you can operate it? And really a lot of them, 99%, if you don't consider those who said, I already knew the device, so it's not relevant for me to answer this question. 99% said, well, I have the feeling, yes, I can operate this device now. And then the next question was, okay, it's not enough that you know it, can you also work with children in a course or in a project with this device? And here we had 96% who said yes, now they feel it. So we found that a really good result, and we also had a lot of very nice feedback in a written form in the discussion forum. So we think it's, I mean, some words about the participants. We had around 4,000 enrollments in the course, and 850 something got a record of achievement. So they really went through the course, did the weekly assignments, the exercises, etc. Half of them were teachers, and half of them were parents. So that was also interesting for us, but we are happy with this because and parents see, oh wow, that's interesting. What they usually do, they go to the school and say, hey, here's something nice, can't we do that at school? Or sometimes they even help in schools, the teachers, to do something with the device with the children. So at the moment we are working on a second course for older children, 5th to 10th, grade 5 to 10, and now we hope it will be as successful as this one. Any questions?
You already told me about it, but maybe you want to share it with everybody else. You told me that you're working on a new approach for a new course that's going to be like with open-ended activities and stuff. Maybe you can tell a little bit more about that.
In the second course, we work with the Calliope team, but also with teachers in universities to develop projects for the different, I don't know how to say that in English, different areas that you have, subject areas. So for, you have computer science, you have, we call that in Germany, MINT courses, so technical courses. And then we have courses that are not MINT specific, for example, history, or Gemeinschaftskunde,
college. Social studies.
Yeah, and then also something that goes across all the different subjects. So we develop projects for all these areas, and we want to show that in the course so that teachers really have the feeling, wow, that's interesting, and that's also something where I can use so that children understand my subject, my topic better than without it. So that is the goal.
Mm-hmm. So since this particular course is about a piece of hardware, the participants have one, right, to work on. Do they just go out and buy one individually themselves, or?
So what we say is, at least in this course here, it's quite easy. So the editors have a simulator, so you can simulate a lot of things, and you don't need to buy it. You can also borrow them, so there are already some spaces where you can borrow it, or you have to buy it, yes. But it's not so much, yeah, it is about the device, but the idea is more about programming and for the children to have something in their hand, because especially for younger children, that's much better than just having a screen.
My question is, I want to produce my own MOOC. Could you recommend a platform?
At least I can say, or let's put it this way. Our platform is a platform that is developed not by SAP, but by HPI, the Hasselblattner Institute. And the Hasselblattner Institute is operating several kind of sister platforms. So for example, there is one also for the WHO World
Health Organization.
Sorry?
World Health Organization.
Yeah. And they also have a white label platform. It's called MOOC House. So a lot of different companies or people can do their MOOCs there. So that would be one, for example, that would fit. And of course, there are also other platforms. So the big ones are Coursera, edX, whatever.
What I actually found when we did that is you tend to underestimate the work because the videos are by far not the most work. So all the like exercises and transcriptions and stuff, that's the actual work to do.
But it's worth it.
Yes, yes.
So imagine you want to teach 850 people in a classroom. That's a lot of classroom.
Sorry, I don't want to monopolize, but our experience with MOOCs has been you get 10,000 people signing up and maybe 100 actually complete the course. Is your experience like that too?
I think when you look at the enrollment numbers, that does not mean that all these people really take the course. Yeah? You already lose a few, they think, oh, it's interesting, but then they don't have time and then they don't go in. Or they go in and then they notice, it's not exactly what I thought about, and then they don't finish the course. So in this course here, when you look, you have 4,000 people who really enrolled, and we have 850 something who got a record of achievement. So it's, you could say you lost a lot, right? A lot of them. We still think it's really good because, as said, if you want to teach 850 something people.
Oh, yeah, 4,000 to 800 is great.
But maybe just to elaborate on that, I'm a colleague of Katrin and also
this is
my
master.
Hi, and I wrote my master thesis about dropouts and how to handle that. And what we found, and this is also why openSAP has been so successful over the past 5 years, is that the context is so important for the completion rates of the course. So this is also what, for example, edX found out in their huge report. much higher, and therefore the completion rate